The secret to selling a million guitars a year is guitars are very loud. Marketing will take care of the rest. It's in guitars, for the most part, we don't need sophistication like a violin. The violin is this small instrument that needs to cut through the orchestra and go out to the concert hall. It has to be very efficient. And we're also looking for complexity of sound. And I'll go into the parts of sound here in a minute. There's parts of sound that you can control on your sound system at home. You can control the volume. The graphic equalizer allows you to make the bass louder or the treble lower. It allows you to control the tone, which is the bright sound, or the warm tone, which is like more like talking underwater. Does that make sense? So tone is bright to dark. EQ, we'll call the graphic equalizer, is bass to treble. Unlike the sound system, we can also control the presence or the projection in the violin, so it sounds good to the audience, not to the player. So before I put you to sleep with that, our idea from the very beginning was to make guitars like violins, to control the sound. And from the very beginning, we really were a custom shop. Today, 75% of the guitars we make are for custom requests. The other 25% are ones that are our models that we think will please most of the people most of the time. And the thing that we do differently than the other brands that you see is we make each guitar with the sound that we want to have. So let's break down the sound for you. In a guitar, there's personal choices. This is no right or wrong. Everything that you can do on your sound system is a personal choice. If there was a right or wrong, they wouldn't give you knobs and sliders. So you're allowed to do that. And in the guitar, you also should make those choices personally. And I just described some of the things you can do with your sound system. And one of the biggest problems people have in buying a guitar is being burdened with the opinions of other people. It's a music teacher, a minister, a player, somebody in a magazine, and things like that. And when it comes to these things you can control on the sound system, that's your choice. It's really your choice for what really feels right to you. Now, the myth that every guitar sounds different, and therefore you get the one that speaks to you. Have you heard that? Yeah, well, that comes from a company that makes a lot of guitars every year. And the idea is making sure each guitar has the qualities that we're all looking for. So you've heard this myth too. That's not a myth, it's very true. You decide on a guitar brand and a model, and the advice is go to many stores, play as many as you can, and pick the good one. And I'll explain how that happens to you in a minute. Wouldn't it be nice if you could order guitar knowing you'd get the good one? So this goes to our violin making. The thing that everybody wants is sustain, that the energy lasts a long time. And the other part of it is overtones. You can hit a note on a piano, and it's pleasant. When you hit two notes, it can be pleasant or not. If the two notes are in harmony, meaning the vibrational links complement each other, it sustains and it develops overtones. It's pleasant. Two notes at random can cancel each other out, and it's flat and doesn't last long. And we play guitars that sound both ways. So we're looking for the guitar that sustains and has overtones. So why not go into the secrets of Stradivarius? This is a good place to do that. And I don't mean to know the secrets of Stradivarius, but I get it. I can see what they're doing. We've had a lot of attempts by science to discover the secrets of Stradivarius. Is it a measurement? Is it something that happened in the weather? Is it a chemistry of the finish? Yeah, all those things could be helpful. It was the gift of the master builder that it came from. And it's, here's the first part. It's very, very simple. I'll teach you how to mass produce. How's that? That'll be very helpful in your understanding of guitar making. I have a friend that directs the Asian company, and I have a good friend in Southern California. The Asian company makes $1 million a year, and the one in Southern California makes a few hundred every day. But their formula has to be the same as an automobile, a chair, an appliance that as a consumer good. And the way you make a lot of them at a good price is your design tells you what the size of each piece is. So very efficiently, you make these components exactly the same size. They can then be put into an assembly where all the person has to do is take the part and put it in a station where it'll only fit one way. And they do that, they pass it on to the next. Now, I don't mean to be to talk poorly of somebody that does that work, but it doesn't. It's not luthery, you know. It doesn't take artistry or judgment to do that. So you assemble the instrument out of these pre-sized pieces, and what you get is you save a lot of time, you make less mistakes, and the guitar comes into the marketplace at a good price. Who could ask for more? That's not the way that the masters did it. The School of Amati's my club, Stradivarius Guarnieri. And what they did, instead of making components to the exact size, they made them to the exact frequency, like a note on a piano. They assembled their instrument, and it was tuned like a chord on a piano. When the strings put it into motion, all of these separate notes or frequencies work together to give sustain and overtones. Do you believe that? I'm on the right track. That is huge. The mass production is very efficient. Luthery is not efficient. It's a matter of judgments to get consistency and a lot of training and a lot of skill. There's your first clue why our guitars are so expensive and what they do. The next secret of the violin makers, you know how old violins are so much more desirable than new ones because of their sound, and guitars too. We talk about the golden age of Martin or Gibson and how these guitars are so much better. There's a lot of reasons why they were better, but one of the strongest factors in why old guitars and violins sound better is that the wood sounds better with age. And here's the, try to make this chemistry entertaining. Within the wood, the nutrients flow through this sticky stuff, hearts, sap we call it, resin. And when the tree dies, the circulation stops, and the wood is like these cellular structures. So think of an apartment building that's now knee-deep in Honig. It's sticky, it doesn't accept vibration. And when you put this wood in an oven and bake it with moving air, you get all the water to evaporate and it goes out of it. But the sticky stuff stays sticky. And this can be a brand new guitar that you listen to, and it may sound interesting, you know, marketing will convince you so, but it's restricted. It's not sounding as good as it can. As years go by, this stuff doesn't harden by evaporation of water. It hardens by a chemical change, polymerization. And the older the wood is, the more it becomes like crystal and the better it sounds. And this has something to do with, someone asked about torrefaction, and I'll go into that a little bit. Or you can ask that question, I'll explain it. So old wood sounds better. And we're not about to wait for our guitars to be 50, 75, 200 years old to impress you. So we cheat. We start with old wood. So of the guitars that you see up here today, we just made a guitar for our 40th anniversary. By the way, we're 40 years old this year. We built a guitar out of wood that was frozen in Alaska for 3,000 years. It sounded really good, but you don't have to wait that long. But imagine, again, this difference between honey and crystal, and that's what happens to the guitar as it ages. So beginning with old wood does two things for us. We get better sounding wood. And this old wood comes from sources you wouldn't imagine. I've told this story for so many years that wood finds us. People call us up about sources of wood. Right now we're working with mahogany that comes from a ship that was abandoned off New Orleans in 1900, 116 years ago. And the interior is made out of mahogany. And mahogany's always been a desirable, valuable wood. And people took that wood, took it inland, put it in a barn, and forgot about it until maybe 10 years ago. And the story I'm telling you about liking old wood got to them, and we found out about the wood. We're also using mahogany that came from a huge bar like in Chicago in 1920, where they served whiskey. And in the U.S. in 1920, alcohol became illegal, and Elliot Ness, Al Capone, they smashed up the bars, and some of this wood still exists. We wouldn't be making a million guitars a year out of this wood, but at 500 guitars a year, we can use this type of material. We get better sounding wood right away and a better sounding guitar. The second thing it satisfies is everything that goes into these guitars. I'm going to call it responsible harvest. We know all the way from the very beginning where this wood came from, and it's extremely important to me personally that we're part of the solution of deforestation rather than part of the problem that creates it. So by using old wood, we're not cutting a tree, and we're part of the good guys and part of the bad guys. There's other ways to get responsible harvest, and we do that too. But what is very cool is someone gets a guitar that they know sounds better because of the choice of wood. They know that it was responsibly harvested, and it sounds better. So you got one of the secrets of Stradivarius, and I actually gave you the second one, which is build the instrument like you're making a chord on a piano. How about a really quick music theory lesson? When you play a note, it's a frequency, it's a wavelength. And when two of these are complementary, it allows the vibration to last a long time or sustain, and it develops a colorful cloud of notes around it. So you play two notes in harmony, and that's worth paying for. You know, the cat on the piano on YouTube is loud and entertaining, but it's not. It doesn't move your soul with that. So it is absolutely possible to make a guitar on purpose that has those qualities that you're looking for. And again, it's not very efficient. Our shop is right now it's 16 guitar builders, and we make a little over 500 guitars a year. And 400 of them go within the U.S. So there's 100 guitars a year that go the rest of the world. And that's why Franz's shop is so exceptional to see this selection here in the instruments. You can see on the little signs some of the woods, but I love talking about wood. In fact, let's be careful so I don't spend the whole time on wood here. Here's another part of our success, and I'm very grateful that we've been able to do this for 40 years. It's not a miracle that we're in business for 40 years. It's a million miracles. Like any business, we've dodged some bullets and had some difficult times. Remember I was complaining about trying to learn how to make guitars when there was no information available? A real answer to my prayers at the time was the idea that if I worked with other people as a team, we'd learn a lot faster than I would on my own trying to discover things anew. Also, another thing my mother gave me is respect for the scientific method. And that is, if you want to see what a change does, you only make one change, and then you see what the result was. If you make two changes, you don't know what it was. And think about making guitars as one person. Oh my God, that'd take a long time. And I'm Californian, I'm impatient. We want it all, we want it right now. I'm better now at my age than I was at 18. But that was the idea for working with a team. And we went from me to three partners, and finally down to this person learning, 40 years later, we're 16 people. And the way we do it is we specialize. Because the only way you get masterful at something is through practice. You do it over and over again, and hopefully you have some very good training to start with. And once you achieve the ability to do it masterfully, it's time to recover the cost of training somebody. We only have one thing to practice on, and that's our guitars. And it's very expensive to train somebody in the process. So each person specializes. But wait, these guys all want to be guitar makers, not hole drilling specialists. People know they have the chance to move from one position into another over time. And we have people there, the most senior member other than me is 27 years, and he could be amongst the best guitar makers in the world. Luckily, he chooses to do it as a team, as I do. And we go down from there. So we have people at 23 years, 20 years, 19 years, 17 years, and we have one very gifted guy that's celebrating his second week in guitar building. So it's a very different way to go about it. And how do we break out of this thing of there's no books, there's no information, there's no internet? One of my teachers, I had two teachers, James Patterson and Bruce McGuire. They're both gone now, and I worked with them separately. One was a classical builder, and one was an amateur steel string builder. And they both, when I asked them, how can I repay you for teaching me, they both said, show it to others, you know, pass this on to other people without asking for something in return. I went, ooh, that's easy, I thought. You know, 40 years later, it's the foundation for our success, and it's this. We always get more than we give. Being open source and sharing our information as builders, we've opened up a whole world coming back to us. It's the Asian company that makes a million guitars. It's people in aerospace, automobile engineering, and acoustic physics, as well as small makers, big makers. And I'm serious. We always get more back than we give, so there's nothing held back in what we do. Our real trade secret, if you will, is the expertise of the violin builders and the 40 years that we've spent doing the process. So if you'd like to know anything, just ask. You all know that Brazilian rosewood is much more bassy than Indian rosewood, and that coca cola will poison you, and so on and so on. No, it's not. The woods give the guitar the tone, the brighter the dark quality, which could be confused with bass and treble, but it's not. How the wood is worked allows you to do to manipulate the bass versus treble. So when we build a guitar, we decide what that's going to be. Woods are tone. So the Indian rosewood guitars would be like a warmer, a little more friendly blended tone. A guitar out of blackwood or cocobolo for back and sides would be brighter and clearer. The guitar with Sitka spruce from Alaska is a little warmer, a little friendlier. The Adirondack or the European spruces are brighter and clearer. And there's no right or wrong there. You know, on the internet, the more money you pay for spruce, the better. Nah, it's buying different flavors or different colors. So here's what it is. Where the tree grows and the nutrition it gets from the soil and the climate will give it a different ratio of weight to strength. And if you think of metal, a poor ratio would be lead. That's very heavy, but soft and weak. And if you tapped on it, it's not going to be a clear, bright tone. And you move to the other end with aluminum, where it's very bright and clear. It's also very strong and very light. So that's what contributes to tone in the woods. The Sitka spruce, the back and side woods. And here's another myth buster. If you put a bright wood with a warm wood, they don't cancel each other out. It's like making a recipe with chili and pineapple juice, sweet and sour, you know, sweet and hot. You get a whole completely different thing. So that's tone. We were talking earlier about maybe brass bridge pins or something like that. That'll change your tone, you know, but let's not go there. So the next thing is, I was talking about bass versus treble. And I won't go into them all, but we have many ways to control this. One is the volume of the guitar. The dreadnought is louder and generally more bassy. You know, the bass slider is up on the graphic equalizer. And that's great for bluegrass, country, some singer-songwriter stuff. But those of you that are classical players wouldn't even take that guitar for free. You know, you want something that's very even, and you as the artist would decide which note to make louder or not. That's a function of the size of the guitar. Maybe you heard these terms, scalloped versus tapered bracing, or forward shifted X, or the stuff that Martin used to do in the old days versus now. They're not better or worse, they're just ways to move the EQ. And for a lot of people, when it's really loud in the bass, they think it's louder overall, because our human ears hear the bass frequencies more readily than the higher frequencies. So some people even just hit the low E string and, you know, decide whether the guitar is good or not. You classical players know better, you know, so do violin players. So this EQ, if you will, from the graphic equalizer is something that's done by how the wood is manipulated. It's not inherent in the wood. The size of the sound hole can change the bass to treble. And the placement of the brace is not just how they're shaped. So now we have tone and the EQ. But remember, what everybody wants is sustain and overtones. That comes from harmony. So in our factory, not our factory, the big factory, we make the braces on a machine, we make the tops on a machine, all the sizes are exactly the same, they go together, and we get random frequencies, like throwing rocks at a piano. The living tree is composed of hard and soft, and when you cut 10 pieces exactly the same size, they will ring at a random frequency. So again, like I said, in the factory, we're putting together randomness. If you throw enough rocks at a piano, you'll get a chord every once in a while, the law of averages. So when you play an instrument that's made by assembling these precise parts, you can find a good one. You know, you can find not so, but you'll find a variety of that. Back to the violin makers, they controlled that by tuning their components or tuning the whole to get the sustain and the overtones. So what does that mean to you guys? The cool thing is you don't have to remember any of this. When we talk to someone about making a guitar, a custom guitar, or advising them on which guitar to pick in Franz's store that's right for you, it's listening carefully to what somebody likes and what they want more of or less of. Usually we all have a guitar we love, except for something. Not enough bass. The strings are too close together. Those are the kind of things. And in our line of models, you know, we have 18 different standard models that you can choose from, but we also know that there's not one right thing for everybody. And I'm going to strongly encourage you to choose one of the guitars that Franz has for your own. But if you play everything he has and there's something missing, we can do it. You know, we can find it. And again, this is not it's not me bragging or boasting that somehow because our brand is cool that we can do things others can't. It's because we choose to do things differently. One of the keys to that is I didn't begin this as a business. I began making guitars. I'm a little obsessive compulsive. That's all I wanted to do. And to support the habit of making guitars, you know, I went, you could sell them. You could buy more wood, make more guitars. And that's really been how we built the business. So we're not a slave to target price in the market. If you're making a million guitars a year, you can be sure you pay attention to how much you pay for materials, how much you pay for the guitar makers, and hit your target. For us, we truly are motivated by doing the best we can. That's a funny thing in the modern market. I get a beautiful chance to go to Eastern Europe and give a talk to a company that builds guitars, and they visited us. We're a cultural exchange. Remember, we're open source. The more we give, the more we get. And technically, there were some things that they liked, but what they were really impressed with is how come everybody seemed so happy? You know, why were people happy in making the guitars? And the explanation was, for me, is that everyone there plays guitar. It's not necessary, but they do. They play guitar. They love guitar. And they have a say. They're able to give suggestions for the business. In some cases, I let them have a program where they can put ideas into place. So they really become engaged, and they're part of it. They get to be guitar makers. Each process is not just putting the holes in the bridge pins. It would be making the bridge from start to finish and setting up the guitar at the end. So there's a logical array of processes that make you feel an ownership in what you're doing. And the funny thing in Eastern Europe, where people under socialism for so many years, is doing your best was a funny idea. There was only one customer, which is the state. So whether you do it good or bad, it still gets sold. And the unfortunate thing is, for generations, they didn't want to stand out. They didn't want to draw attention to themselves. So working quietly without being up or down was your goal in that. So try to bring this idea of California there is going to be really a fun challenge. But it's a fun one. Remember when I started at the beginning, I was saying that the keys to our success are kind of interesting. We don't have secrets. We don't stick to a formula of dimensions. In fact, we do everything wrong to be a successful manufacturer. But when we're done, the instrument that we make is a very dangerous tool. My friend, who I really respect in Asia, 1 million guitars a year. And here's what he says. He's a very spiritual guy. And he says his service to humanity is to make the most guitars possible at the lowest price range so more people can play music and the world will be a better place. Right on. I have great respect for cheap guitars. He also said he knows what Santa Cruz is doing is we're trying to make the most inspirational tool for someone to really speak what's in their heart when they play their music. And our guitars are used in some incredible situations. Our guitars are used to attract volunteers to bring clean water, our nutrition in places in the third world. They're used in ministry, education. They're truly nothing till they leave our shop. But once they leave our shop, they can do wonderful stuff. So our job, again, is to make the most inspirational tool we possibly can for the player. I'm a lucky guy. It's a lot of fun that I have with this. So not keeping secrets, being open source, trying to give more than we get. And I always remind myself this every day when I go to work. I'm in the service business, you know? As a guitar maker, that's just my vehicle for giving back. And somebody much smarter than me said, the key to happiness is in making other people happy. And we all know how that feels. You know, there's really nothing that feels better by having done something helpful or good for others. And that's the foundation of our business and what we do. I encourage you to look at your own jobs that way. There's nothing out there that's not service to others. And the way that we train ourselves at Santa Cruz is doing your best is a reward in itself. It gives you satisfaction. You feel good when you go home at the end of the day. And seeing the results of your work out in the world, no matter what you do, is also really pleasant. So I'm sorry you didn't come here for my philosophy. You came here to hear about guitar making. But when you play these guitars, that's what you hear. You hear the heart, the intent, the ethos of what we do. And I'm happy to answer any questions, although by now you may be afraid to ask questions. So again, I want to thank Dietmar from the bottom of my heart. He's very important to our success. Franz for taking the great leap of faith in the investment in us. So What else do you want to know? I can talk a long time.
Maybe one about wood.
Sure.
Get started in classical guitar making in the 70s or so. Cedar became used wood for top of the line instruments, but mm-hmm. you rarely see it in steel string instruments.
What was the wood?
Cedar.
Oh, cedar.
Yeah.
Cedar comes from Northern California, Washington State. In fact, it grows around the world. But remember, we're looking for a specific weight to strength. And I wish I have this example that I do on a tour, and it makes people's mouth drop open. I have a piece of cedar from a tree that was probably 500 years old, and the tree was cut. It's baked in an oven. All the water's gone. And when you knock on it, it's very musical. It's very pretty. And then I have a piece that was underground for probably maybe 1,000 years. And the tree could have been several thousand years old. And when you tap on it, it makes you jump. It is so clean, clear, and resonant. I don't know there's anything better in the world to make a guitar top out of. But remember, these are flavors, colors. And we use cedar specifically to help someone achieve a certain result. Think of when you play a finger style, you're using your fingernails instead of a pick, so less energy goes into the guitar. Also, with that, many people are using an open tuning where you tune the tension down, so less tension is also less energy going in the guitar. And cedar has the ability to respond quicker with more volume than spruce does, given the same energy. So we just like a classical, making a guitar out of cedar for that purpose is almost like a magic in what it does. So yes, we do use cedar. There's a myth about it, which is, oh, but it doesn't last very long. The tonal life is maybe 75 years. That comes from the Spanish makers that didn't use cedar the first time, really.
Maybe another myth that it's, for spruce, you need a longer time to play it in. That's the same that goes around. And cedar is more ready to immediately sound like 30-year-old spruce or whatever.
So, you know how I explained to you how the factory makes instruments by making pieces all the same size, putting them together? They also do that no matter what the wood. So Sitka spruce, European spruce, cedar, redwood, koa, mahogany are all the same size. And cedar needs to be thinner than spruce to get the same response. So the violin maker or the classical maker knows to vary that thickness to get the proper deflection. The factory can't afford to do that. So the classical maker can bring the best out of cedar, whereas most people play a factory guitar and they listen to guitars and they go, ugh, maybe it'll be better in the future. So here's another secret to why old guitars sound better than new. And one is the tension that's built into an instrument. Think of bending the sides, forcing them into a mold, and making things go together. And when the strings put energy in the guitar, it's restricted. But over time, this assembly will relax and it'll become more fully resonant. That's another reason older instruments sound better than new, and it's one of the secrets of the violin masters. They made things fit together, so it was a relaxed assembly. So old wood, building the instrument in tune with itself, building a relaxed assemblage, and there's one more that borders on hocus pocus or mystery, and that is, you've heard people talk about how guitar plays in. And maybe if you put it in front of a speaker while you're at work and blast the speaker, it'll sound better. Well, here's the physics behind that. The top, the back, and the air all have a fundamental note that they make. We can't change that. That's a note, and the airspace is a note. And if the instrument is excited, as acoustic physicists say, at that frequency, it will de-dampen the instrument. It'll make it more resonant. And I go back to violin building. So here's a secret from the violin makers. I'll use a crazy example. If you got the Netflix or a movie and you watch it at home and you bought an ice cream on a little stick and you ate the ice cream and you just play with the stick while the movie goes. A couple hours later, the wooden stick is more flexible. You didn't bend it so much to break the fibers, but it got more flexible. So the de-damping actually comes from a French translation, a style of building in France, where the wood was worked before it was done to give it more elasticity, to de-dampen it. The English word dampen is like you hit a cymbal and put your hand on it dampens it. So de-dampen to make it more resonant. And one of the very cool things that was a secret amongst the builders is the young guy that came in as the apprentice. Maybe his first job was to sit on a stool like this, and there was a place in the violin top that was secret to the maker. That he did that for a long, long time to make that part more elastic and de-dampen it. So the frequency that the top or the airspace vibrate at, exciting the instrument, will de-dampen and play the guitar in, if you will. All the other notes are just noise. And to do it with the speaker is not very efficient. And I shouldn't tell you how to do this at home. That might be dangerous. But I have a dear friend, Roger Siminoff. Maybe some people remember his name. Roger developed a very simple thing. It's I'm sure you have electronic stores where people that can do hobbies make things. And anything that vibrates is a little motor with a weight off the center, and you turn it and it goes blah, 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 blah. And as you give it more energy, it goes faster. It's just like a frequency in a wave. So you have this little motor, and then you have like for the toy train, it's a transformer. You know, you turn it up, it'll go faster. You turn it up, it'll go slower. And if you tie this to the bridge, I don't even know what we call this, cable tie. It's a little plastic that you loop and pull tight, and make sure it's tight, leave the strings on, and do it to that, and you turn your transformer until the guitar howls. You know, until it, whoa, it, when it hits the frequency that is its fundamental frequency, it will really howl. And the reason we don't make this for the marketplace is, can you imagine the insurance that you'd have to have, or somebody has a loose brace or something? But that effect over, let's say, 24, 48 hours, it'll be noticeable. There's devices on the market, but they're safe. Yeah. And being from California, we don't like safe. We want it now, you know. So that is a way to imitate what happens over time in playing. But the biggest part of what's happening in the old guitar sounding better is the relaxation of the tensions from the build and the wood becoming better sounding. And the de-damping is proportionately, if the guitar is made in a factory really stiff, the de-damping could become a huge part of the sound. But if the guitar is made like I was describing, in tune with itself, resonant, put together under a minimum of tension, the de-damping is only a small part. So we don't de-dampen the guitars by doing that process. We leave that to the player in time. Whew. Did that give anybody ideas?
In one of your internet videos, you are explaining this tonal behavior of your spruce on the, of
yeah.
the sides
mm-hmm.
of the backs. So I was asking me, what are the goals this guy is selecting?
Sure.
When it comes to harmony, so are you looking for a unison behavior, or are you looking for a harmonic behavior? For example, in terces or quads or quints or something.
Yeah.
Like this. So that's the question.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
I always kept in mind for this evening today.
Here's a great
rich interest.
Yeah. Thank you. Here's a great secret from Santa Cruz Guitar Company. Harmony A harmony is when two vibrational lengths, or three or four or five or ten, are complementing each other, and it doesn't interfere with the energy. It lasts a long time. So that's harmony. Harmony allows sustain, and it develops the overtones. So if you want to get all three, you only have to measure one, because none, they all can't exist without one. You can't have sustain or overtones without harmony. I wish I'd brought a guitar top. When we shape the braces, the first thing we do is we shape them for the proper EQ for the instrument. But then we tune them so that each brace rings as a note to make a chord. And to measure each one and what it was would drive me insane. So we're listening for sustain, because the more it sustains, the more it's in tune. When we get the maximum sustain by holding and tapping, we know we're in tune. So people, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so people are always asking me, to properly voice and tune a guitar, you'll need to know the fundamental frequencies, and the back should be half a semitone off the, you know, and I go, I don't know how to do that. But I could tell you this, we can get the effect that you do by doing it scientifically and mathematically, and if you measured it, you'd see we did it right. But we don't have to do those calculations if we have sustain. Sustain is a product of all of that scientific explanation. So if you were doing this on your own guitar, you could begin with copying the shapes of a guitar you like. Let's say a Martin or a Santa Cruz carve shape. Ah, that looks just like that. And then you tap on the top, and you go, let me try a little bit around the edges. Ah, the vibration's lasting longer and sustaining. It helps if you do 4,000 of these at your table in the kitchen, and then you'll get it. And you'll know how far you can go before it starts to turn the other way. Also, you have to remember the top has to be strong enough to hold the pull of the strings. So you can tune the instrument to maximum sustain and overtones just by listening to the sustain.
I understand you right. For example,
that's remarkable. Not many people do.
I never would do this, but I lay down one of your guitars on my kitchen table, and I very even put fine sand on it, and I hit the strings. Mm-hmm. Then I will get some harmonic pattern on it.
Yeah, what is that called?
And the opposite,
Chaudhry?
For example, this million guitar builder guy, which makes precise things, mm-hmm. which he puts together, would not be that harmonic in this pattern as you will be.
That's, if we did that to our guitar top, some people do this before the top goes on the guitar. You know, they'll tune it. I can't remember what it's called, Chaudhry patterns. His name is after a scientist. And a certain shape will give you the sound that you want. I would say that we achieve the same thing in our listening and feeling to the top. If at the end we put it down and listen and saw where the sand, or usually it's a metal filing, goes, we'd see the same thing as somebody that started with the metal filings and changed to get that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because honestly, someone's not trying to achieve something esoteric or hard to understand. They're trying to achieve harmony so we get sustain and overtones. That's what sounds fulfilling to us. And when people talk about sound like wine, they're only talking of different variations and descriptions of these fundamental things that I just taught you. So I don't mean to argue or say something counter to somebody that spent their life tuning guitars based on this formula. That's just not the way we do it. But we can achieve probably the same results.
Thank you.
Good, I hope I'm right.
So you are building every guitar in a different way.
Yeah.
And you're shaping the braces, mm-hmm. the things in a different way, and you knock on the top or wherever and try to hear what is going on.
Doesn't that sound crazy? It's funny, this is the reason science has so much difficulty understanding why Stradivari violin is so amazing and so consistent. They go into the instrument, they measure everything carefully, they maybe get a little chip and do a chemical analysis, and they go, okay, we've got it figured out. They go to the next one, and the dimensions are different. How could you have consistent sound with varying dimensions? I just taught you this, because you are given random density in your piece of wood. By moving it is how you get the consistent sound. So yes, every guitar that you'll play here, the measurement of the top is only a coincidence. That's what the measurement was when it was sustaining the most. But it's very close. We work within probably 2.9 and 3.2 millimeters. So it's only about that's a lot, 3/10 of a millimeter in this. And 1/10 of a millimeter make a change. It could be the difference between fighting each other and really being in tune. So we also do that with the top before the brace is gone. So yes, as a scientist, if you were to measure three guitars exactly the same, it would really annoy you that the measurements were different, but the sound would be consistent. And that's the secret of the violin builders. I think it's funny that somebody from California that's only been making guitars for 40 years would think they know the secrets of Stradivarius. I say it out of utmost respect. In fact, I find it disrespectful when science says the reason these violins were beautiful is because of the little ice age, that the wood was special. It's discounting the gift of the masters that built. I heard some questions before we started that I really liked. I could ask you to ask them, or I can spoil it and give the answers.
You mean the one about projection?
Yeah, I love so that. I love that.
So classical guitar, maybe just to,
yeah.
Just
okay, here's bit. This is very. I think this is very cool, and it's not my idea. And I've had a chance to hang with some very important Spanish builders, some violin makers, and you know, those guys don't give secrets. You know, the Spanish guys are very macho, you know. They'll let you know by the watch that they wear. And they're not about to give away the secrets they got from the master. And the old style was the master passes the secrets to an apprentice who does it in a line. And something happened in the U.S. Maybe 45 years ago. We started making guitars, and we didn't know how to do it, so we began talking to each other. And our body of knowledge grew together and expanded. So I found this out from my classical guitar trainer, and I learned it in violin, and it was verified by some famous Spanish builders. Once I told them what it was, they were like, "Ugh, how did you know this?" So this is pretty simple. You know, when you look in the sound hole of your guitar, you see the little slotted pieces of wood that run around the corners. That's when the guitar top is put to the sides and the cut is made for the binding. The top sits on those, not the sides. It sits on this material. And that's a big secret of how you control the projection of the guitar. So here I'll use a imaginary Spanish builder. The luthier makes his name and reputation on making a guitar for the master. You know, Segovia, Richard Gallen, somebody that's playing and performing. And from that, he's able to make his living and pay the rent off selling guitars to students, people that want to sound like the master. And those two guitars have a different purpose. The one for the master really is going to send as much energy as possible out to the audience. To sell them to the student, you want it to sound the best here while they sit in a chair and decide whether to buy it or not. And this comes from violin making. The violin must project as efficiently as possible. Who cares what it sounds like back here, like a speaker cabinet? We want the energy out here. So here's how this is done. If you look into a violin or some classicals, you'll see these are white. If you look into most American steel strings, they're brown what's going on here? Remember we talked about cedar and how resonant it was, how beautiful sounding it is? We call them linings, like the violin. If you make this out of cedar, when you pluck the string, it's like dropping a pebble in a pool of water, and that ripple moves to the edge. When it contacts the cedar, it moves very readily into the sides and the framework of the guitar, and the player gets volume. But if you make this out of a wood like a linden, basswood, which is very, very soft, the vibration, like the ripple, moves here, and it doesn't transfer. It moves back into the top, and it pumps more air that gives more volume to the audience. Do you believe this? Try it. So in the classical building, that's a very good way to change the direction of the energy and the projection of the guitar. There's others. How much weight is in the neck? This is a very classic experiment. If you were to play your guitar and carefully put a metal clamp on the peg head, people will say it's so much louder. It's not. It's still the same energy, but now instead of the energy moving into the neck, it's concentrated and it projects more. So the guitar, the energy goes more directly to the player. And one of the ways to control the presence in a classical build is to decide how much weight you want to do that. You do that after it's built, and there's places you can put weight that nobody knows you did that. I've told secrets. I can't believe it. But there's, and that's physics. It's not my opinion. That's the way you can make the guitar project to the audience or back behind you.
Putting this metal clamp, I hope I understood you right, on the headstock.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Use something soft like a leather.
Can it be seen equally to an acoustical short circuit,
mm-hmm.
which reflects?
Now that's interesting. That's interesting.
I'm asking because I'm
an electrician,
RF technique guy, and
yeah.
I'm working a lot with reflections and.
I'd love to know the science behind that, but as I said, we may be achieving that, but we're not smart enough to know that. What we do know is when we put that clamp on, more energy goes to the audience instead of like this. But when we make a guitar for someone that's doing singer-songwriter. Let's say a group like this acoustically, we'll make the neck lighter so that energy becomes part of the resonant surface and it's more open and airy. And it's very dramatic. So if we do a 12-fret neck out of a low-density mahogany with a slotted peg head and open gears, it's very open sounding. If you took a jazz archtop guitar and use a neck of a horn that is really heavy, big peg head, very heavy gears, that cuts crazy through all the other instruments in an orchestra. Remember the films of the old big band, and the guitar player, every note is a different chord as he plays, and the idea was like to really cut. You like that answer? I didn't make it up. Blame it on the Spanish, blame it on the classical builders. But that's a very cool trick as a guitar maker to be able to do that. That stuff. You know also what does that? The violin doesn't have binding like the guitar, but it has this little black line. It's called a purfle or purfling when you do it. And that also breaks the connection to the side and keeps the energy within the violin. And it's not made of a solid wood, which would have hard and soft parts. It's made from wood that's ground up and then done like paper, and then laminated and done, so the density is uniform as you go around there. You're not supposed to know that either. Is that okay? Yeah, you'll think about that. Yes, sir.
Very, very simple. I learned that you're in love with wood.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But on every guitar, not only on yours, this plectrum cover, this protection,
yeah.
protection is plastic.
Ah, that's great.
Why?
That's great.
Yeah. I would love to have it
Because the classical player, as we know in Europe, you learn to play young and you learn to wash your hands, put on a nice something with no buttons, and lay maybe a deer skin on your. And when you're done, you clean it and put it back in the case. That's not the steel string guitar player at all. With that, I'm going to say it comes from people using the guitar in popular music, and they're buying a steel string guitar, not a classical. They're buying something that's made for the mass appeal, and it's made to be strong and durable. You don't want to, if you're making, you know, a million guitars a year, or back, let's say, in 1920s, there was no distribution. You couldn't send the guitar something to be fixed. So the guitars are made very strong, and they didn't sound great to start with, and the way you made them loud is you hit them really hard. And Willie Nelson's a good example of a guy with a hole in his guitar. So this is in the English luthier, I think they call it the scratch plate. And it means, you know, you keep from scratching the guitar. So a lot of what we do has to please players that are used to the Martin Gibson look, and the what we call the pick guard is part of it. And you're right, some of the crazy old cheap guitars actually was a piece of plastic that was screwed to the top. So what? How can you do this and minimize the effect on the sound? It's the same thing we do with our lacquer or our finish. The guitar itself is made of wood, which is cellulose. Cellulose is the material that makes wood. It's also cotton. Cotton is cellulose. So if we melt the cotton with a solvent, we turn it really into liquid wood. That's what we use for our finish to the guitar, and that's what this is made out of. So if you look at it on the with a microscope, it is fibrous, and it has the ability to resonate. It's complementary in its resonance to the wood. It's also much thinner than most of them do. So we've done careful listening. You know, measuring on a machine can show a difference, but it's only important if you could hear it. And I can't tell the difference with that on or off. Mm-hmm. But you're right. For some guitars, it's just part of the assembly, and it doesn't do it any favors. Torification. Lot of noise about that. When we first heard about it, it was a very specialty process, very expensive, on very few guitars. Now we see guitars advertised at $300 US with this process, and it's a way to make wood have more of the qualities of old wood than new wood. So. Remember, you can take a piece of wood from a living tree, bake it in an oven, and in hours it's dry enough to build a guitar out of. But the resins are sticky, and it doesn't resonate well. Torrefaction is the process of, here's cellulose or plant matter or a dinosaur or whatever's left over in the muck in the ground. And over time, that would first turn to charcoal, and then coal, and coke, which is very close to torrefaction. And way over here is a diamond. You know, after a lot of heat and pressure, it turns into a diamond. So the torrefaction, as I understand it, is a way to heat it enough to destroy the hemicellulose, which is a spongy part of the cell, and to burn out the sticky resins. The temperature needs to be high enough that the wood would catch on fire. But if you do it in a vacuum with no oxygen, remember, for fire, we need a fuel source, oxygen, ignition. If you take one out, you don't get fire. So if you take the oxygen out, you can get it very hot and do this process. And we've experimented with it, and it's pretty impressive. It really is. You can take a piece of wood that's not as good sounding as it would be after that process. And I think it's a remarkable thing for guitars, cheap guitars that otherwise might not sound as good, to do that. The problem is there's no one place to go have that done and have control. So when we had it done, we had to pay a lot of money to be able to control the process, and we got good results. But to do it on any volume, you would have to develop the system yourself, and I think it's about 12,000 US to make this. But remember, torrefaction is a way to make wood sounds like it's old, and what we do is we use old wood. So nothing against torrefaction, but I prefer, you know, the real thing with that. It's a neat process. Good science.
Can you say anything about the strings you use? Do you have to think about what strings will I use on this guitar afterwards before building it? So you have to imagine the connection between strings and guitar. And how do I find the right strings for my guitar?
Once you hear my answer, you'll think I paid him to ask this question. So remember, we're controlling everything on the guitar just like you would on your sound system, including the graphic equalizer. So our Dreadnought guitar for bluegrass has a predominant bass. Our fingerstyle guitar is more even. So when we buy strings from a name brand, we're buying exact measurements. You know, even you guys use fractions of an inch, you know, they go from 12 thousandths to 53 or 56 thousandths. That's how strings are sold. But from maker to maker, they all have a different idea of the ratio of the wire core and the wrap. And one string from different brands can be as much as, I'm doing metric, probably almost 3 kilos of pull. That tension is what controls the volume. So when you move the sliders on your graphic equalizer, remember you're changing the volume. So when you buy a brand of strings from one maker, it will change the EQ on your guitar depending on how it's made. You buy strings from another maker, it'll be different. And where I really started thinking about this is it really bothered me that the strings would change the sound of our guitar. But who's going to make strings? That's a process. Then I heard a couple of things. Tommy Emmanuel, who's a bit of a player, in an interview, they asked him, what kind of strings do you use? He says, I use 6 different brands of strings. I go, aha. He's looking for tension, not the size. He's looking for tension because when he makes his own set, he decides the EQ of his guitar because these strings of this tension make this louder, this softer, and he gets the EQ he wants in it. But there's another cool thing here. If you could control those tensions and put them in a logical array, remember, the guitar works by putting the string underneath the top and locking it. It pulls up, it goes across the saddle, and pushes down. So the way that the guitar pumps air is this rocks, and it rocks and it pumps the air out the sound hole. If you were to put different strings and you don't know what the tension is, it's like having a cart being pulled by different kinds of animals, and each animal has a different length of leg. So the bridge is fighting. So you put 100% of energy into the bridge and it gives back 70%, 60%, because a lot of the energy is going into these strings fighting each other. So the solution for us was to design our own string. We can build the guitar the way we want, and then we designed a string where we control the tensions and we can get the EQ and we get a more optimal movement of the bridge. And it's remarkable. It solved the problem. They feel better. They feel more logical when you play them. The sound is fuller and louder because the bridge works better. And we get the EQ that we want. And that was a great solution. So we don't build the guitar to the strings. We built the strings to our guitar. Really? Yeah, really. And that we took 12 years on that project. And it would be unfortunate if I didn't say Franz has those strings here. You should give them a try. What you'll notice different about them is where the wrap rounds are on the ball that you put in the guitar and the bridge pin holds in. It's not a little donut of cheap metal. It's a solid pure brass ball, and the winding is very precise. And then I explained the other attributes of that. What we had to do is we had to get specially precision wire that then the wrap goes around, because you know, all gauges are the same. Ours are, the reason we don't put the gauge or the size of the string is we had to go, let's see, in thousandths of an inch. Sometimes the G string can be as light as 0.022 or 22 thousandths. We needed to go to 0.0215 or half of a thousandth of an inch to get the right tension on that. So like our guitars, they're expensive, but the value in them you'll see for yourself. So we didn't make strings to give the world a new string brand. We don't need that. There's plenty of strings. We made those strings to bring out the best in our guitars. So hopefully that answers your question, but it gave me a great opportunity to promote our strings. With that, we kind of do the same with our cases. Our cases are our design that we have made by a company rather than buying other companies' designs. And the more we can control the things that go with the guitar, the more we can assure, you know, complete quality. That might be all I know, but try ask any other questions you have.
Maybe this could be interesting for a few guys. Can you tell a few words about your climatic behaviors in your plants?
Yeah, I really will.
This article with very great interest.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's a good thing to
pay. Yeah. The humidity, the amount of moisture in the air, is the thing that affects the guitar the most. Wood is called hydroscopic. It'll take on moisture and lose moisture, unlike metal that won't. So when there's a lot of water in the air, when it's humid, the guitar takes on moisture. The top will rise up. It'll sound a little bit dead. When it's dry, the top will come down and shrink, and it'll sound good, but it also might crack. So the solution is to build the guitar right in the center of the world. We can send a guitar to Stockholm, Sweden in the winter where there's no moisture, or we can send it to Singapore where it's super humid and we only have half of that extreme exposure. And we also know if we sell a guitar to the guy in Stockholm, he'll go on Craigslist and sell it to the guy in Singapore. So it's going to move around. So by building in the middle, we have the broadest bandwidth of safety for the guitar. The extremes are still very, very dangerous. So we don't build at Santa Cruz weather, we make our own weather. So the shop is constantly within a temperature range and a moisture level that's the middle of the world. It gives our guitar more durability, but it doesn't make it not move. The only way to make it not move is to build it heavy enough that it won't sound good. I shouldn't say not sound good. Remember, interesting, and marketing takes care of the rest. But to make a truly sophisticated instrument, it can't be that heavy. If you play Martins of the Golden Era, Martins from 1930s, I don't know what those are up to, $100,000 or something like that, and they're so desirable. But the weight of them is a fraction of the modern ones. You have to compromise. It has to be light enough to be resonant, strong enough to last. So our guitar isn't the guitar to put in the trunk of your car and go to a festival and leave it in the hot sun. You know, that's not going to work well. If you took it into a very dry climate, it'll probably crack. And one of the things that that we spend a lot of time with education with people is this isn't a guitar that's built for strength as opposed to sound. So some of us have had the pleasure of buying a new car, they always tell you at 300 kilometers, bring it back. Don't wait for 500 kilometers. Bring it back at 300 kilometers because the engine will have settled in from hot and cold, and things will become a little loose, and we need to go back and reset the proper torque of other things. A good guitar is the same way. It'll leave our shop in California under controlled humidity. It can go anywhere in the world and be pretty good, but probably within the first few months of the guitar, you'll greatly benefit from bringing it back to your dealer for adjustment. And I won't go into the physics of what happens to the guitar, but the combined things that will happen, the top pulls up slightly. Remember, the bridge is rocking, so it pulls it up in the back, pushes it down, and that makes the top a little bit shorter. The back is pulled by the neck from a curve, and it straightens a little bit, so the whole effect is the string's coming up a little bit higher. So there's two things that can be done with that. One is, this is a wear item like a tire on a car, this little white saddle, and it can be lowered from the bottom, bring the strings down, but also there's a metal rod in the neck. It's not there for strength. It's there to shape the neck for how hard you hit the string so it can move properly. Also for humidity changes, if you're in a dry climate or a wet climate, it can do that. So there's another self-promotion, but you can't build a guitar in the humidity that the customer is in, because it will go someplace else. Does that answer the question?
Thanks.
Good, okay.
There are a lot of videos how you can adjust the neck.
Yeah.
With, you did it by this guitar.
Yeah.
As I came in.
Yeah.
Is it possible to do it by myself?
It is.
Or I shouldn't do anything?
It is. It's kind of the requirement. It's funny. I'll about to do it anyway. Our requirement for a new guitar maker is, first, we want a good roommate, you know, somebody that's good to live with. The second thing, well, actually, this is necessary too. God gives us either a hand-eye coordination from our genetics, or not, or somewhere in between. And with an understanding, if you do work where you make your own things, or you've repaired things, or you do an art or a craft, it trains your brain to think mechanically. And if you're comfortable with that kind of thing, this is very easy to do. In fact, I'll risk a demonstration here. Before we became successful as guitar makers, we were very popular repair shop. We did restoration on very expensive instruments, and the way we paid the rent for the shop before our guitars started to sell was repairing the broken pig head on Gibson guitars, where this big hole was there to adjust the neck. So the idea when we designed our truss rod is, instead of having it there, let's have it in here where it doesn't do that. The other thing is, that's ugly. And our truss rod is very precise, very sensitive, but it's also very strong. And if someone that doesn't know what they're doing were to just turn it, they could break the neck. Yeah. So we hide it from people. And the next thing we wanted is, we wanted an adjustment that you could buy anywhere in the world. You could go to a store that sells tools for working on the automobile or working at home, and it wouldn't be difficult. This is something you use for anything mechanical. And this part is 8 millimeters. Yeah. In the U.S., we can also call that 5/16. So they can go to the tool store and buy American, or here we buy 8 millimeters. And so with all that good intention, people still think there's no truss rod because they can't see it, and they think it requires a very special tool to get. So I was wrong. But anyway, the adjustment is, it works two directions. It works both to bring the neck into a curve forward, and it also pulls the neck against the strings. And there's a place in there that's just right for you. You probably heard some companies brag about they don't have a truss rod because they put their neck in the proper place to begin with, and it's solid. You don't have to worry about it. Whew, how would you feel if you went to buy a new car and you couldn't see out the rearview mirror? but the salesperson told you, oh, the factory's put that in the right place, you don't need to touch it. That's like the truss rod. It's a very, very, very personal thing. So this wrench will actually engage just like that. And the design of this is you turn a lever and it turns it one way, you turn the lever, it takes it the other way. So I can make the neck go back and forth in any shape with that. And yes, you could do that yourself. And earlier we had maybe you saw the 5 euro note I had here as a precision measuring device. And if you played pretty lightly, you could probably get away with, if you hold the string here and here, it actually makes a straight line. And the space between the bottom of the string and this fret is the relief or the curve. And if you put the euro note in there and it just barely sticks, if you play very lightly, it's probably okay. But if you play harder, you need to fold it in half or fold it 3 times or even 4 times and have that clearance. And that would be right for your playing style. String doesn't move how we think it does. It is crazy. Guitars were built forever based on the idea that when you fix the string here and here and you pluck it, it's fuzzy here, so it must move the most in the middle. And that's why the truss rod was developed, to put this curve in that would complement that movement. But we would do that and we still find the strings want to buzz here and here first when you play them. Don't know why that is, but the common practice was, if the guitar is really cheap, who cares? You sell it anyway. The more expensive the guitar is, the more likely the shop will go in and file those frets a little bit until it goes away. If the guitar is really expensive, the maker does that, so you don't get a buzz there. And what we found out was, the travel from the top of the distance the string moves from the top of the fret to the board, the more it travels, the sharper the string becomes and more out of tune. And when you file here and not here, the travel is different here than here, and the guitar doesn't play in tune. But that's what we're used to. That's the sound we're used to on guitars, is not quite in tune. So we studied the movement of the string. Does a strobe light translate well? It's a light that blinks really fast. So we made a line of them and watched the string, and it puts the string into a slow motion. It's amazing. When you pluck the string, that's 100% of the energy. So the string moves more here than it does here. So we need the most clearance here. And when you play it here, it's like jumping on a waterbed. It bounces here. That's why this was rattling. So we changed our style. Instead of filing these frets, we shaped the board before the frets go in to the proper shape. When the frets go in, the tops of the frets are in the right spot, and it plays more in tune and more consistent with tone. That is really hard on the wrist. You know, somebody training to do this maybe takes 1 year to get masterful, and they maybe have one more year before they have to stop.